Today I have to make this brief introduction to the economic situation of Europe, and then we shall discuss together, you know, because the basic point, everybody of you know them, and the most important is to try to deepen with our conversation, which will be the outcome. First of all, is clear that in this historical moment, Europe is the weakest spot in the world economy. The figures are very simple. GDP 2012 world average will be probably 3.5, around that. China 7.6, United States 2, Europe 0.2, 0.3, if things go well, 0.4. So it's there is substantial difference with other countries. And inside Europe, and the crisis is general. You know, even Germany, that is the best behaving country, will grow 0.6 this year, you know, and France 0, Italy minus 1.5, Greece minus 1, minus 5.4, and to give you how the situation is difficult, you know, Greece is minus 5.4 after 2 years in which was minus 3.5 and minus 6.9, put together how is the deep sufferance of the country, you know. So it's, you understand how this monetary malaise, these difficulties, is translating in tragedies in daily life, in daily life of people, you know. It's and you know, generally, the responsibility for that is due to the. In the economic literature, to lack of productivity, overcost, big deficit, and then the deficit is the real bad guy, you know, and everything is concentrated as a consequence in checking it. But it's a strange case, because if we consider the euro area together, deficit will be this year in monetary union average 2.9. United States is 9. You know, it's not so bad. So it's how it is really a contradiction. You know, that, you know, and you have almost the same deficit in Germany, that is 0.3, almost nothing. In Italy is 1.2, 1.3. Deficit, you know, so even in countries that are under stress, the public deficit is under control, you know. But deficit is under control, but and this is for me the real danger, the real tragedy of the contemporary world, with the unemployment that is increasing, you know, of course with different situation country by country, but is a general trend, and it's from it changed from 4.5% in Austria to more than 20% in Spain, but you have this disequilibrium that is characterizing all the more developed countries between full employment and you know, the trend of the economy. In spite of that, you know, Europe, if you take the macroeconomic situation, we are still number one in GNP in the world, around 21-22% of world GNP. United States is a little less, it's 20-21. We are number one in industrial production, number one in export, you know, and still a strong reality of the world economy, you know, even if from today to the forecasts, you will have a sensible decrease of European relevance in the world. You know, I don't mention all the forecasts you have that in 2040 we shall be only half of the American economy and less than half of the Chinese economy. I don't want to go into these forecasts because forecasts are almost always wrong. But it is clear that if we project today's situation, there is no doubt that this will be the future reality. And clearly, there are, as a consequence, two statements. First of all, Europe will become more and more irrelevant in the future. Second statement, because of this tension of the problem that we have today, the euro area will, let's say, will end, and there will be, as a consequence, a dissolution of the European Union. I don't agree on that, and this will be the point of my short conversation. But we shall try to analyze why and how we can get out from the existing situation. First of all, I have to remind that the history of Europe has always been in history of ups and downs. It's not the first time that we have a deep crisis. We had even deeper crisis. I remember only the so-called period of the empty chair, in which France left its chair empty in the European Union, and everybody was talking about dissolution of Europe. And then, you know, the British referendum, the problem of the constitution, all this problem that. And in spite of that, Europe was always enlarging and deepening. And now we arrived from the 6 members to 27 members and almost half a billion people, you know. Nothing compared to China, but a remarkable number of people, you know. 496 officially members of the European Union, and clearly we got enormous results in this history, results that have never been got in history. We changed the concept of a Westphalian modern state, you know. And, this is the reality, and if you think also to the euro, the currency is one of the two pillars of the Westphalia modern state. You know, the currency and the army, and changing one of that, we have changed the concept of states, and so we have been a great laboratory in world politics. In these years, and clearly we did that with many differences among European countries, among different politicians. Even when you think to the euro was conceived by an agreement between the euro, the idea of a common currency was an agreement by the German Chancellor Kohl and the French President Mitterrand, but the underlying concept of the common European economy was completely different, you know. And Kohl was, in his idea, there was a strong federalist union, and Mitterrand, it was more, let's say, initially founded, you know. But Europe always went on with this compromise, with a clear idea that the union among European states was an historical necessity. And so it's, I am not surprised that after a period of great creativity, there is now a period of difficulty. You know, if you think that in very few years we enlarged from 12 to 15 to 25 to 27 countries, absorbing countries with a much lower rate, much lower income, and what it doesn't happen in general in economic areas, this was with increasing equality among different areas. Let's say the peripheral areas have grown more than internal areas, all with a cost, an expenditure that of the federal, let's say, of the European institution, that was negligible. You know, the budget of the European Union included bureaucracy, agricultural aid, regional aid, research is less than 1%. I repeat, less than 1% of European GDP. So it's when people talk about bureaucracy, the big bureaucracy in Brussels, you know, everything is done with less than 1%. I concluded my period of commission with a budget of 0.96% of European GDP. So we have the achievement that are uncommon. But, you know, after this period, well, of course, we couldn't get the euro with the weapons necessary for the currency. You know, the first question that you could arise is why you need a common currency without a common fiscal policy, that everybody understand that it was necessary. You know, I rise in the program, I make interview on that, calling the pact under the euro stupid, you know, and I paid a big price for that, because it was clear from an economist that you couldn't have a common currency without a common fiscal policy, you know. And I do remember that, you know, when I raised the problem to the German chancellor, who was the hero of the euro, he was wisely answered, look, we did a lot. The German, my electorate, didn't want the euro. I wanted the euro for a big, a strong political and economic goal, you know, because I want peace, I want a European Germany, not a German Europe, and so I want to link my country to a common, but you can do everything now, you know, and time will follow in which this necessary economic decision will be taken. But then what happened in Europe? The years of fear. Fear of what? Fear of globalization, fear of Asian competition, fear of immigration. You know, Europe, in many countries of Europe, immigration was completely unknown phenomenon. I am Italian, you know, in my country. We have always been a country of immigrants. In 20 years, we changed so much that now we have 12% of non-Italian living in Italy. That is completely a change of mind. And people was in some way shocked by that. And so the mood working in the direction of progress, it changed. And the leaders, of Europe, they started to understand that it was so difficult to make progress, you know. And the first countries not to respect the rules under the euro, the so-called stability pact, were France and Germany, that didn't want, you know, why? Not because of irrationality, but because the electorate was starting to be more and more afraid. And politically, it was clear that it was necessary to have common rules, but this could not be done against the willing of the electorate, you know. And so we entered in this moment of increasing difficulties, you know. When I explained to my Chinese students this short history of what we did in Europe, you know, big laboratory and now the problems, you know, a student of mine asked me, "Professor, but Europe now, is it a laboratory or is it a museum?" and this, you know, it was a question that it was striking me, because he was right, you know, but it was a museum because of this political event obliged us to stop this process, but not an eternal museum, you know. I think that it was some stopping in a process that I hope will go on. But would you have the decision that have necessity to be taken in that moment, you know? First of all, was necessary to have a superior authority in checking the behavior of the government, but this was not accepted. Not even a statistical office. And the answer by France and Germany was no. My initial account cannot be controlled by a superior authority, and so the Greece government, excuse me if I use this terminology, they cheated. Simply cheated, you know. The national account was were simply wrong, you know. It's, and so we lost the momentum of the authority to have a coherent, long-lasting, coherent monetary policy. But in spite of that, for 7 years, the euro worked well. And the storm on the euro, it came from outside. It was not a storm arising from Europe. It was the monetary, the financial storm induced by the world crisis, and Europe was in some way the victim of the problem. And what I want to underline is that my thesis is that it's more a political problem that we have in our hand than an economic problem. You know, that when the Greek problem started, it was absolutely negligible, respecting Greece, a great country, but it's 2% of European GDP. You know, 2% is 2%. And we could manage the crisis in Greece with 20, 30 billion euros easily, closing the chapter and going on. And, there were not the rules to do that. And the most important country in Europe, that is to say Germany, the German electorate was not in the mood to accept any clear aid to any ailing countries. And politically, you know, there were elections in North Rhine-Westphalia, and it's quite interesting that the first decision was taken 5-6 months after the crisis, the night after the elections, you know. And, you know, because there is a God, the Chancellor lost the elections, you know. And this is the political reality, that member states were not ready to create new institutions, new controls, and so we have, and we still have, always weeks and weeks of discussion, and all the decisions taken that I shall illustrate them, because they have been in the right direction, the European decision taken by the many summits that have been repeated during the time, they are all in the right direction, but always late, and always of a small inappropriate in quantitative terms to the necessity, because of the political necessity of taking the decision only when there is some general agreement in the electorate, you know. And this is a I am illustrating it as a European problem, but if we think deeply on that, this is a problem of all the democracies, all the contemporary democracies, you know, the problem of taking decision appropriate in terms of dimension, and the shortening of the horizon due to the elections, you know. This is the problem we have more and more, like the problem of the new, let's say, fiscal instrument necessary, that are all problems, long-run problems. And the election shortened the horizon of the decision. And this is, I repeat, this is not a problem only a European problem, because if you link this fact of having elections and you mix it with the opinion polls, that makes any election, even the most local election, as important as a national election. This is another evolution of our democracy, you know. So I do remember, and it's an anecdote, but it's quite interesting to understand how difficult is the decision-making process, you know. When I had a meeting with the Chinese responsible of the foreign policy of the Communist Party on this problem, you know, and he was raising me, telling me, how can you handle in your Western democracy this long-term problem like aging, like social security, like that, you know, that you have municipal election, a provincial election, national election, European elections, and any election, because of opinion poll, becomes a national election, a fundamental election. And the example was not only European. When you remember when you had here the election of the substitution of Senator Kennedy with the majority 60-40, the change was changing the mood of American politics, you know, while in theory was a negligible event, you know. But this is the problem, that in the euro policy it becomes more and more my real fear is not only concerning euro, but how you react to the great problems of a modern democracy that you have in front of you. And second, you have internal change in Europe, you know, that are clear, but they are not put under our observation. Let's say the entire situation of Europe has completely changed, because in the last 20 years Germany has become the leader country in Europe, you know, and we have in theory a two-piston engine, France and Germany, but in real terms you have not anymore the previous equilibrium, and this changed the political the process of the decision-making process, and this a lot because you have usually, you had in these past months always a summit between France and Germany before the European summits, you know. So a pre-decision before the decision. Of course, this was making angry all the other countries, but it was also a strange case, because it was clearly a biased situation, you know, in which there was a more strength from one side than from the other, you know. I use it to tell that, probably I'm exaggerating, she has taken the decision and he made the conference press, you know. I am raising this problem because I think that the solution of that must be in a French initiative to coordinate and elaborate more the political action of all European countries, not to counter by Germany, because this is an old concept, you know, but just to present an alternative policy that will tranquilize Germany, but will start the European recovery. Because my point, you know, and we arrive now to the center of my short conversation, my point is that, as I told you in the beginning of my conversation, from the macroeconomic point of view, the situation is not so bad, you know. The budgets are in some way in good order, but every day the speculation hits, so there is anxiety and ups and downs. And so the reason is not in this macroeconomic, but in the fact that in the figure that I have given you in the beginning, that you have this good effect, positive effect of the decision taken by the different government, but you have no recovery. And you have this increase in unemployment, uneasiness, and lack of hope, you know. We need to get out of this problem. We need to get out of this moment of stagnation. I told you before that the decision of the summit were in the right direction, and I repeat this because there was the creation of a stabilization fund of the European Facility Stability, but without changing the basic instruments, you know. And so the European Central Bank has no possibility to be a central bank like the Federal Reserve System, but they made an easy, easy money policy, helping the different country to get out of the problem, but always in an unofficial way, that was not illegal, but in the limit of the possibility of the bank, you know. So always going like a bypass in the blood circulation of the continent, you know. And this is why we have no possibility to tackle the real problems, you know, that are very simple. To have the euro bonds, let's say the treasury bond, not of the different European country, but of the continent, you know. Why with a deficit of 9% US bonds are safe, even if the budget of California is worse than the budget of Greece. You know, this is that because US is a big dog and nobody buys a big dog, you know. And so Europe is so divided that this is pound by pound, you know. Very simple political explanation, you know. And this is the situation, you know. And second, to give the power to the central bank just to regulate not only the inflation, as it is still the rule of the European Central Bank, because it's impossible to do something different that the present president is doing without violating the law. And so, but to give power to act as a regulator of the of the circulation as the Federal Reserve. The Federal Reserve is doing, you know, and in this situation, as I told you, another characteristic is that we need also a common policy, because the structure of the European economy is diverging country by country. This is not even in the United States, you have difference between Oklahoma and Texas and California, you know. But if you don't regulate it, I don't know where they will bring. You know, if you take today structure in manufacturing, now is fashionable to talk about coming back of manufacturing. You know, if you take that, the added value of manufacturing in Germany is around. Could be around 25% now, 24% of GDP manufacturing, considered only manufacturing, without construction, without service related to industry. And in France is 11, UK is 10, and going lower, you know. And so, of course, in services is the reverse, you know. And so you should need to regulate. To regulate, to harmonize this difference, or take the consequence of this difference, you know. And clearly, this you cannot do without strengthening the central government, the central government of Europe. And this is because of that we are assisting to continuous turmoil, ups and down, without any explanation, any economic explanation. You know, last week we had the spread, the difference between Spanish and Italian bonds, with the German bond increasing enormously in one day, you know, with a political reason, not with any economic reason. But tell you that the future. There will be dissolution of the euro? No, because there is no country having any interest to do it. Germany has never been so good with the euro. When there was no euro, all the European countries devaluated, and Germany couldn't never have any surplus in their economy. You know, I tell you an example. You know, when I started my academic career, the rate of exchange of the Italian liras with the Deutsche Mark was 145. When I signed the entrance of my country into the euro, when I agreed with Chancellor Kohl, it was 990. We devaluated 600%, and France not much less. You know. And now, in the last 10 years, Germany has increased the surplus. And last year only, Germany had a surplus of 2,000 billion euros. You know, that is unbelievable high. And so, if you take the balance of trade of Germany is a surplus of 5.2% of GDP. Let's say, to be very synthetic, you know, the real China in the world is Germany, because the German surplus is higher per capita, per income than the Chinese one, you know. And so this is, so the business, the German business community, even the left right is doesn't want to give any money to the lazy southern people in which I am proud to belong, you know. But when you go to the real problem, there is no interest to dissolve the euro. And the reverse, in a country like Italy, I wanted to enter into the euro because I wanted to give a discipline to the country. And people understand that we couldn't go on devaluating, you know, because you make a country rotten, you know. And so there is, the euro is some plus, is a win-win, is a win-win game. It's not a neutral game. And so it's this is why I'm really convinced that the euro is not collapsing, you know, and even more in the next months, you know, because the U.S. presence is terrified by the idea of having a crisis before the elections, you know, and so even from outside there is no rational reason to have this situation. Clearly, the problem is that we cannot go on with restrictive budgets forever, and so we have the necessity that even the surplus countries understand that is their interest to make a common policy in which, you know, the problem of adaptation is not only on the shoulders of the country in deficit, but it's also the shoulders of the country in surplus. You know, how many times U.S. blamed China because of the excessive surplus? I think that the situation of Germany is not different from that. You know, so we need a rebalancing of the situation, and I think that step by step we shall be obliged to go in the direction of the recreation of some common policy, let's say, especially in the direction of the euro bonds and reinforcing the central bank. Clearly, we need also step by step to make new institutional progress. When I met the European students a few hours before, they asked me which was the outcome, the definite outcome of this crisis. And, you know, of course, my answer was very simple. You will have a unity only when you will have elections at a continental level. You know, if you will have a challenge between, let's say, a French socialist vis-à-vis a German Christian Democratic or vice versa, this will be the moment in which you will cement Europe, you know. But we need time, and the effort, the laboratory has worked well, you know, has worked in the right direction, you know. It's if I remember the difficulty that we have, you know, when I was president of the commission, I never pronounced one word in Italian, you know, because it was not a working language. But when I entered into the European Parliament, I was speaking only Italian, you know, because my identity. So to harmonize these two aspects of a political life, is a big effort. But I think that this is worthwhile, because this is the future of the world. This is the future of the world. Of course, this can be put in action only with a stronger leadership inside and outside Europe. You know, and we are in a period in which this will not be done soon. You know, even in non-European decision, I don't think that the next G20 will change the world, you know, because we are in a moment of change in which no one has interest to big reforms now. But we have to keep the compass in the right direction, as we have done, and the museum will come back to be again a laboratory. Thank you.